Good morning, DEI. Can you all stand to your feet? Hallelujah. As we gather to worship, as we gather to praise. Hallelujah. For this is the day that the Lord has made. And we will choose and we will purpose in our heart to give him the glory and to give him the praise. Why? Because he is an awesome God. He is a worthy God. He is a magnificent God. And we honor him this morning. So can we just take a moment and honor him with the sound of victory that comes from the clapping of our hands, that comes from our voices. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We won't let any rocks cry out for us today. Hallelujah. We will lift up our voice. We will give him praise because it's due to him. Hallelujah. Just look around you. We are alive. We're breathing. Hallelujah. We have the activities of our limbs. Hallelujah. Some of our limbs may hurt this morning, but we still have them. We have the activities, so we're going to give him praise. So at the count of three, can we just begin to open up our mouth and act like we're in somebody's football stadium and give God glory? One, two, three. Did your neighbor make any noise? Hallelujah. Did somebody else on your row make any noise? Just in case they don't have enough Jesus or victory today. Come on and open up your mouth for them. Hallelujah. We're going to help support each other today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I have enough for me. And I have something that I can share with you. So come on, one more time. Give God praise. Yes, sir. Glory. Yes, Lord. And I can do it because there's freedom in the house. I can do it because I'm free in my heart. I can lift up the sound because I'm free in my mind. And I bless the Lord that I'm free today. Hallelujah.
I'm free.
I am free. Praise the Lord. I'm free. I'm no longer bound. There's no more chains holding me. My soul is resting. And it's just a blessing. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I'm free. I am free. Praise the Lord. I'm free. No longer bound. There's no more chains holding me. Come on and help us give God praise. Hallelujah. Glory to God. There's a sound we're getting ready to lift today. Hallelujah. Come on. Yeah. Come on. Clap your hands. Yeah, yeah. Oh, there is a sound. A sound. No fear is holding me. Nothing.
Lord, He's been so good.
Praise the Lord.
We can either rock from side to side, or if you're like me, you just like to jump a little bit. But whatever you decide to do, we're going to let freedom in the room. We want power to fill this room. We want Jesus to fill the room. Come on. Can we lift that up this morning? Oh, let freedom fill.
Let freedom fill the room.
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 Let power 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 fill the room.
Let Jesus 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 fill the room.
Let glory 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 fill the room.
Jesus fill the room.
Let 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 Jesus fill the room.
Freedom is here.
Let Jesus fill the room.
Deliverance is here.
Let Jesus fill the room.
Joy is here.
Let Jesus fill the room.
Peace is here.
Let Jesus fill the room.
Healing is here.
Let Jesus fill the room.
You can have whatever you need.
Let Jesus fill the room.
Jesus is here.
Let Jesus fill the room.
Come on, tell him to fill you, fill you. Fill me, Lord. Fill me, Lord. Fill me, Lord. Fill us up, God. Fill us up, God. Fill us up, God, until we overflow. Come on, you ought to say, I want to overflow. Come on, look at your neighbor and say, I want an overflow. Glory, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Y'all feel good this morning? I said, do y'all feel good this morning? Come on, you ought to clap your hands for Jesus this morning. Come on, let's thank him. Come on, you ought to thank him. Thank him because you know he's been good. Thank him because you know he's sitting on the throne. Thank him because you know he's got it all in control. Hallelujah. Father, we come this morning because you are the only one who is able to keep us from falling. Your spirit and your power is still available to us if we call on the name of Jesus. And you said, if you call on me, I will answer. God, we're calling on you this morning, Jesus, to come into this room and meet us where we are. God, we need you more than ever. And we ask you to pour out your spirit upon all flesh. Lord, we ask that your will be done in our lives. God, we ask right now in the name of Jesus that you will heal, deliver, and set us free in the mighty name of Jesus. God, we thank you for all that you're doing in our lives. We magnify your name this morning. And we lift your name up. It's higher than any other name, God. We praise you. We glorify you. And we ask that you would bless your people today. We ask that you would send your rhema word through your male servant, God, in the name of Jesus. We ask you to bless our leaders. Bless our co-laborers in the gospel. Bless our auxiliary. And God, bless our new building that is coming forth this year in the mighty name of Jesus. Let it be a beacon of light to this city, to this county, to this nation in the mighty name of Jesus. Come on, if you agree with that, come on, shout to the Lord this morning. Hallelujah. Good morning, DEI. Good morning to our online family. We are so excited and happy that you have decided to join us for our worship service today. Please like and share this content in our page. Hallelujah. God is doing a new thing.
Yes, he is. Yes, he is.
God is doing a new thing. Are you ready? Are you ready for it? Are you ready for it? Come on, let's read our scripture. This is our divine scripture reading of the year, Joel 2, 21 through 32. Fear not, O land. Be glad and rejoice, for the Lord will do great things. Be not afraid, ye beasts of the field, for the pastures of the wilderness do spring. For the tree beareth her fruit. The fig tree and the vine do yield their strength. Be glad then, ye children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord your God, for he hath given you the former rain moderately, and he will cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain, and the latter rain in the first month. And the floors shall be full of wheat, and the vats shall overflow with wine and oil. And I will restore to you the years that the locust hath eaten, and the cankerworm, and the caterpillar, and the palmer worm, my great army which I sent among you. And you shall eat in plenty, and be satisfied, and praise the name of the Lord your God that hath dealt wondrously with you. And my people shall never be ashamed. And ye shall know that I am in the midst of Israel, and that I am the Lord your God and none else. And my people shall never be ashamed. And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions. And also upon your servants and upon the handmaidens in those days will I pour out my spirit. And I will show wonders in the heavens and in the earth, blood and fire and pillars of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness, and the moon into blood before that great and terrible day of the Lord come. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be delivered. For in the mount of Zion and in Jerusalem shall be deliverance. And the Lord has said, and in the remnant of whom the Lord shall call, the Lord is calling you higher. I said, the Lord is calling you to a place that you have never experienced before, where the vat shall overflow and the field shall be ripe with harvest. Come on, can you receive that word on this morning? Woo, hallelujah. Somebody say, I receive that by faith.
I receive that by faith.
I receive that by faith. Woo, hallelujah. Come on, let us worship. Come on, let us worship. Hallelujah. Ooh, hallelujah. Come on, lift up those holy hands unto the Lord. Hallelujah. Something stirring. I feel high winds blow, bringing freedom, releasing miracles. I will listen. Before I see, I know that He is on the way. Glory is on the way. He's on the way. Glory is on the way. I hear a sound, and it sounds like heaven. I want heaven in my life. Yeah. I hear a sound, and it sounds like heaven. I want heaven in my life. Yeah. Come on, can you be a testimony of that?
Step in, all fear is distant. It can't stay here, and I am comforted that when you're moving, all enemies will say that He's on the way. Yes, He's on the way. Glory,
He's on the way.
For the dead, yes, but for the breathing and the alive. Heaven is here right now. Heaven is here right now. Heaven is all around. Heaven is all around.
It's not far away. Heaven is right before my eyes. It's not just for the dead, but for the breathing and alive.
Heaven is
here right now. Heaven is here right now.
Heaven is all around.
Heaven is all around. Heaven is all around. It's not far away. Heaven is right before my eyes. It's not just for the dead, but for the breathing and alive. want heaven in my life.
Kingdom come, your will be done.
I want heaven in my life.
Your kingdom come, your will be done.
I want heaven in my life.
Your kingdom come, your will be done.
I want heaven in my life.
Your kingdom come, your will be done.
I want heaven in my life.
Your kingdom come, your will be done.
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 Kingdom come, your will be done.
Your kingdom come, your will be done.
Your kingdom come, your will be done.
Your kingdom come, your will be done.
Heaven is here right now. Heaven is here right now.
Heaven is here right now. Heaven is here right now.
Heaven is all around.
Heaven is all.
Come on, do you want heaven to come down? Come on, do you want heaven to come down? Heaven is here right now.
Heaven is here right now. Heaven is here right now.
Heaven is all around.
Heaven is all around. Heaven is all around.
Heaven is here right now.
Heaven is here right now. Heaven is here right now.
Heaven is all around.
Heaven.
You ought to speak that over your life this morning. You ought to speak that over your family this morning. That heaven is here. Heaven is all around. You at home, glory is here. And glory is all around. Come on, if you need healing this morning, you ought to say, healing is here. Hallelujah. Come on, come on. Clap your hands. Come on, you ought to praise him this morning. He's been so good. He's been so kind. He's been so merciful. How can you not praise him? Come on, we saw his power this week. He caused the moon to move in front of the sun. He's coming the same way, you know that, right? He's coming the same way. Come on, you ought to praise him this morning. Hallelujah. 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 He's a good God. Come on, let's praise him a little bit more. Before Pastor comes, let's praise him a little bit more. Come on, put the fruit of praise on your lips this morning. Praise him, praise him, praise him, praise him. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright a blessing, he's prepared for us a place. And I can see the light coming, and I can see the day dawning.
When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Sing and shout the victory.
Come on, praise him. Come on, let's say this together. Onward.
Onward to the prize before us. Soon his beauty will behold.
Soon those pearly gates.
Soon those pearly gates will open.
And
we will walk those streets of gold.
And I can see the light coming.
Yes.
And I can see the day dawning.
Yes. When we all get to heaven. Curse will be broken. We're gonna see every word you have spoken. All of the earth will be filled with your glory.
Oh, I can't wait.
Oh, I can't wait for that day when we rise up. Every tear will be wiped from our eyes. We're gonna see you and sing holy, holy. We'll shake, every curse will be broken.
We're gonna see
every word you have spoken.
All of the
earth will be filled with your glory.
We're gonna sing.
Come on, don't stop giving him praise. Don't stop giving him praise. Come on, lift those voices and put a dance in your feet and give him glory in the house of God this morning. Hallelujah. Come on, let's give God a good praise. Thank you, worship team. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Amen. Thank you so much. Come on, don't stop praising him just because they're coming down. It's all right. It's a good time to give him glory and to give him praise right there. Amen. Has he been good to you this morning? Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory be to the Lamb of God. I'm so excited about being in the house of God this morning. Amen. He has been so good and so faithful. Has anybody testifying this morning about the goodness of Jesus? Amen, amen, and amen again, amen again, amen again. I personally am grateful, amen, because he has done more than just been good. Somebody shout, he's just been God. Somebody missed that one. I said, he's been more than good. I said, he's just been God. He's just been God all by himself, amen? Glory to God, glory to God. You may have your seat in the presence of the Lord. I'm excited about sharing the word of God with you all this morning. It's good to be in God's house. It's good to see you all. Amen. Would y'all agree with that? Amen. It's good to see you all. I hope y'all greeted somebody this morning. You just didn't come in with your nose up and didn't speak and just came in not about you. Amen. I hope you spoke to somebody this morning. If you didn't, it's a good chance to do that right now, to turn around and greet somebody in the house of God. Amen. It's a good opportunity to greet somebody. Especially somebody that you don't know. Especially somebody that you don't know. Some of y'all a little too familiar with your crew. Amen. It's bigger than your crew. It's bigger than your crew. I want y'all to start getting to know each other. Amen. How you gonna pray for people? Intercede for one another. You don't know them. Amen. We all family. We all family. Ain't no silos in the kingdom. Y'all with me this morning? Come on, y'all, get this. Let's get it right now. Let's get it right. Let's get it right. Let's get it right. I can't have it today. Let's get it right. Let's get it right. Get it right. Get it right. Get it right. Y'all hurt me yesterday. Y'all hurt me yesterday. Get it right. Amen. Let's get the ring out. Make whatever adjustments you need to make right now while I'm going, while I'm talking. Get it right. Get it right. Amen. Get it right. Y'all can keep praising him. I'm good. Y'all can keep praising him. I've been ministering straight for the past 15 hours. I did 4 hours straight Friday night with two breaks for 15 minutes. And then Saturday morning, I went for 3.5 hours straight with a 15-minute break. Then yesterday, we had the funeral. So my voice is extremely tired. And so I can't be up here straining with the mics ringing and stuff. They got to get that corrected. Amen. There's a pour and a pull that comes on me when you guys pull on my spirit. And so I need every department in here to get in alignment. Amen. I need y'all to get in alignment. Amen. Because if I'm going to stay before God for you, I need y'all to have this house right. I need y'all to have this house right now. Amen. I'm talking about from the security, the parking lot, to the ushers, everybody. I need y'all to get it together. Get it together. This is God's business. Amen. Y'all expect the best out of me. I expect more than that out of y'all. Amen. And it's okay for me to say that. Praise the Lord. I'm not mad. I'm just setting order. All right. I'm not mad. I'm just setting order. Amen. Y'all want a top-notch word when y'all come see me coming, don't you? Okay. Well, I want top-notch service. Amen. Meet my standard. Meet my standard. Meet my standard. If my standard is excellence, that's what I want coming back. Amen. 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 They getting there. It's all right. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. It's getting there. It's getting there. It's getting there. Yeah, there you go. There you go. Now it's coming where it needed to be. Praise the Lord. That's what I'm talking about. There you go. There you go. There you go. Amen. Now, if I start pushing, amen. Touch me right here and easy on the house so we don't get a big ring, okay? I got faith in y'all. Y'all gonna get it together. Amen. Amen. All right. Listen, the Lord has been good. His mercy is everlasting, and His truth endures to all generations. David said these words, and every time I think of these words, I get excited. He said, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. And this morning when I got up, there was something that stirred in my spirit. Lord, I done messed up and left my phone over here. Something that stirred in my spirit. And I wanted to share this with you all this morning as I came out. And I pulled it up on my phone really quickly. And it was a scripture that blessed me. And I didn't tell you all in the back, so don't drop your head. I don't need you to show it. I just want to read it to you right quick. Because the worship team and the chorale was singing about that heavenly experience. And as y'all was ministering, I was feeling heaven stirring on the inside of me. And the more y'all sang, the more excited I got about Jesus. Amen? And I got to laughing a little bit when where'd she go? She did her little lead part. And then the prom girl, Aubrion. And right when she got finished and she sang so beautifully, and then she took off and ran up there and got on the thing up there. She was like, I'm getting off this stage and I'm getting right back up there. But look, you're gonna be just fine. Y'all encourage her in the Lord. Amen. Your worship is beautiful and your spirit is beautiful. So be encouraged. Amen. Nobody's gonna push you down. And guess what? So even if you mess up, it's still okay. I keep teaching y'all, this is the place where you learn to get it right. That's right. This is where you learn to get it right. We all mess up at some point. So anytime you see, don't be like, oh, I don't want Apostle to say nothing. Yeah, you do want me to say something. Because if we say something to you, it's in love. And then when God starts using you in other places, in those areas, you got it right. But you got it right in church. Amen? You got it right in church. So that's what the house of God is for. It's for training and for development. It's to build up. Hey, look, some of these guys in here, you see Pastor Davis looking at me right now? Listen, let me tell y'all something. Some of them learned to turn wrenches. They learned to put roofs on buildings. They learned to lay drywall. Am I telling the truth in here? Learn to paint. All in church. All in church, because we made certain that not only when we had people that had certain skills to help teach it, right? But anytime we had a special project going on, the house came together. And between the house, we got the job done. We saved thousands and thousands of dollars doing in-house construction work ourselves. Amen? Praise the Lord. Apostle Walker, years ago when you were supporting the ministry, the music department, that building that you guys was in, that we were in over off of, what was that? Off of Mary Kirk. What was that, Strickland Bridge Road? See, about 2 years before we met y'all, the whole roof in that building collapsed. And the exterior wall back there where my office was had blown completely out. And the city was getting ready to condemn that building. The men and women in this church stepped in and in 45 days put that building back together. In 45 days, they pulled that wall back in, had a new roof on the building. We had to hire somebody to put the roof on, but they couldn't put the roof on until we got the walls up. Amen? I'm talking about every classroom that y'all saw, everything came down, and everything went back up new, interior and exterior. So, y'all, I say all this to say that we got some newcomers that's done come along, and if God can get us through the toughest days where we had the least amount of resources, surely now the Lord God is able to do much more than this. Don't put it on the front end and then tire out on the back end. Somebody shout real loud, keep the momentum. Keep the momentum. And if you keep Jesus first, amen, He will keep on pulling you forward. And so I said something today, this morning I got up and I said, Lord, I said, I want you to speak to the people today in a manner that's going to challenge them, but I want you to challenge their faith. I want you to challenge their faith. And here's what the Holy Spirit told me. He said, I know some of y'all been listening, but I need you to respond. He said, I need you to respond. He said, I know some of y'all been listening, but I need you to respond. And I'm not talking about responding to my preaching. He's talking about when the word of God is being released, that you respond by putting works associated with your faith. That's the response God wants. Listen, we don't need another cheerleader for another preacher. Y'all okay? We don't need a cheering squad. We need intercessors and prayer warriors. We need people that know how to get into God's presence and keep the word coming forth. We got that piece. But what God says, he said, I don't want you to miss out on what I have for you because you're waiting on a response. God said, I need you to start engaging with the word of God just like a reflex. When somebody hit your knee, pop, I want you to respond just like that. Somebody shout, respond without even thinking. That's what obedience is. That's what absolute surrender. Y'all ought to go and read some of them old books written back in the 1800s by Andrew Murray. There's a book by Andrew Murray called Absolute Surrender. Absolute Surrender. Franklin Hall. Y'all need to get into some of these old books. Some of the old books that some of the old authors and writers used to write. See, those books was written and they didn't replace false narratives concerning grace. It was a raw, uncut truth in there that spoke about deliverance. Read books by Billy Roberts. Y'all don't know who Billy Roberts is, do you? Soul Saving Station out of New York City. Come on. I want you to get into the history. Amen. It goes well beyond what we're taught in our theology schools. Well beyond what we got taught in our theology schools. Madame Guyon out of Cincinnati. Oh yeah. So I'm saying names that y'all don't know. These are patriarchs and matriarchs, men and women that God used for centuries that had the media showcased certain people. But when you saw some of those miracle workers that were showcased on TV, let me help y'all understand something. Those just the ones that made it on TV. But God had thousands of people on the backside of the desert that he was raising up that had healing ministries and ministries where the baptism of the Holy Ghost and fire was falling down on people. Amen. And consuming entire neighborhoods and communities being filled with the Holy Spirit. You see, the church, our level of expectation about a move of God have got to be more than just that personal Savior experience that we want. This thing, we got to have a love for the whole body of Christ. Amen. Somebody shout, we got to love the whole body of Christ. We just can't love our tribe and love the people that look like us and love the people that pray with us. Amen. If God has called us, amen, into a place of ministry, somebody shout, he's called us to the body. He's called us to the body because he loves his bride family. He loves his bride. And all that come in to the body of Christ that participate in bringing service to the body, we have to love people the way God loved them. Amen. Is that all right? All right. Somebody lift your hands up right quick and say, Apostle, read that scripture you was talking about. Just tell me. Say, read that scripture. I'm going to read this scripture, and I'm going to see how many faithful people we have that's going to be able to respond. Look at this. It's in Luke chapter 5 and verses number 17. And I'm just going to read verses 17 for now. And depending on the response, this might be the lesson for today. I don't know. But I'll wait and see if the faith is in the right place. But it's Luke chapter 17. I know some of y'all going to respond because guess what? You've been experiencing supernatural healing here over the past since the first of the year. God's been doing some miracles in your life and you have witnessed healing come. But look at this here. It said it came to pass on a certain day as he was teaching, there were Pharisees and doctors of the law sitting by, which would come out of every town of Galilee and Judea and Jerusalem. Look at this. And the power of God was present to heal them. Now I'm going to tell you something now. There's something about the gospel. There's something about the gospel of Jesus Christ. I witnessed over 70 people this weekend in a classroom setting with no organ, without a worship team, through the gospel message of the kingdom, begin to be baptized legitimately in the power of the Holy Ghost. I seen people get delivered of racism. I seen people get delivered of discrimination. I seen women get delivered of abuse, and there was none of the extras going on. It was just a people who had a hunger and thirst for righteousness. And through the message of the kingdom of God, we saw every race of people, every ethnic group, every social class. I'm talking about in Bible college, people, it turned into a flat out revival because the people came with the expectancy to let God do what he does best, and that's move mountains, that's break yokes and deliver people out of all level of sickness and disease. This is what the church is supposed to be demonstrating to the world. And instead of that, we are trying to copycat the world's influence. But had I kept y'all to understand something, I still believe by faith that God's holy universal apostolic church is still the most important place on the planet. Hallelujah. And if we, the church, can represent him well, then we should be sending the power of God through every single community, through every single ethnic group. It should be flowing in our professional world. It should be flowing across the media every single time the saints gather. And don't worry about the ones that won't, because my Bible tells me that where there's two or three that are gathered in my name, he said, there I am in the midst of it. I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, the power of God manifests itself every time the saints gather. What we have to do is raise our expectation and say, God, if you're here, I just need you to show me why. God, if you're tired of this, show up. I just want to lift my hands to you right now. And I'm not even going to be selfish. I'm going to take on the words of David and say, Lord, any way that you bless me, I'm going to be satisfied. If you decide to heal me, I'm going to be all right. And if today's not my day, I'm still going to be all right. If you decide to save me from all this trouble, I'm going to be all right. But if you decide not today, God, you're still all right. Because there's one thing that I can testify, that you've been so good to me that if you don't do anything else, I still owe you a praise. I still owe you a thank you, Jesus. Is anybody in here got anything to be thankful to God for? Come on, somebody. I want somebody to let the world know that my relationship with God is not a show. And when I come into the presence of the saints, I come with expectancy that somebody walked in this building with an anointing that's going to be released and it's going to bring me into a place of destiny. Have thou not known? Have thou not heard that the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, he changeth not, neither is there any searching of his understanding. I'm telling you, he is our Jehovah Jireh. He is our company keeper and our burden bearer. He is our all in all and the lifter of our heads. He saves the old man. He'll save the old woman. He'll save the white man and the black man and the red man. God has no respecter of persons. His power is available to heal. Somebody in here, give him a unified praise. If you're expecting God to do exceeding, come on, lift those voices all over the building. Lift those voices all over the building. Hallelujah. Lord, we thank you. And Father, we bless you in this place. We glorify your holy name. And Lord, we welcome the power to heal, the power to save, and the power to deliver. Touch every person in this building. Touch every family under the sound of my voice. And God, we declare that you shall arise and our enemies will be scattered. There's none like you, O God, in the heavens and all the earth. And Father, we worship you. We worship you in this place. And we thank you for what you're going to do. Thank you for just being God. Thank you for just being our Savior. Thank you for just being our healer. Thank you for just being our deliverer. Thank you for just being our all in all and the lifter of our head. Oh God, we bless you. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. I said, he's been too good to us. Ba 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 san da 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 ba si ete. Lift every distraction. Bind up every demonic interference. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, we call this place holy grounds, holy grounds, holy grounds, holy grounds. Doubt, you're not welcome here. Fear, you're not welcome here. Resistance, you're not welcome here. But we invite in expectation. We invite in faith. We invite in hope and love. We invite in a good report by which men shall believe. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Hallelujah. Glory be to the Lamb of God, who was, who is, and who is to come. Oh, Jesus, glory be to your name. Hallelujah. Make this place a sanctuary. Make this place a sanctuary. Make this place a tent of meeting in the name of Jesus. And we bless you. We bless you in this place. Yeah. Glory be to the Lamb of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Just greet somebody right quick and say, can't nobody do me like Jesus. Hallelujah. I say, can't nobody bless me like him. Can't nobody bless me like the name of Jesus. Angels bow before him. Heaven and earth adore him. I declare he's a mighty God. He's a mighty God. He's a mighty God. How good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It's like the oil that runs down the beard, even the beard of Aaron. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Down to the hem of his garments. There's a place that the Lord will command the blessing. Somebody shout, I command you to be blessed. I command you to be blessed. Ha! Let you sit here and die. No, no, no. I command you in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus Christ. I command you to be healed. I command you to be delivered from it, to be saved from it by the power of the Holy Ghost. Heal, Lord, heal. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Ooh, so I see angels. Yeah. I see the angels of the Lord. I see the angels of the Lord. I see the angels of the Lord. He said the word was being taught and the power of God was present to heal. I'm not going to miss my moment. In the name of Jesus, I'm not going to miss my moment. I'm not going to let a hard heart cause me to miss my moment. I'm not going to let a bitter spirit cause me to miss my moment. I'm not going to let fear cause me to miss my moment. God, you're here and you're present. So we know that you're here. We know that you're able. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. There's a spirit of reconciliation in the house. There's a spirit of reconciliation in the house. There's reconciliation. There's reconciliation in the house. Whew. Come down real soft for me, guys. Real soft. You're doing good. Just come down real soft for me. Real soft. I want y'all to be more excited about God than you are about your preacher. I want you to have an expectation that God is going to move through your minister. But don't you be more excited about me than you are about the one that's able to save. I'm nothing without him. I'm nothing without him. I need him every day of my life. I need him every day of my life. My job is just a little different. I got a little bit more responsibility, but he loves us all the same. And my commitment to him and to his people is I'm not going to let people get this attitude where they're going to worship me and won't worship God. All that we do should be doing to his glory, not to Kevin's glory. Amen? I'm just the administrator, the manager, and the facilitator, the overseer of what he's assigned to us for the church and for the global church, not just DEI. I want y'all to understand that. It's not just DEI. It's the church that I have the assignment to. And so we have to have people who love God's church. And y'all, hear the heart of your leader this morning. We got to have people to love God's church. Not even just DEI, but love the church. Because when you love God's church, the offering of yourself as a living sacrifice is no longer a sacrifice, it's an honor. The things I witnessed this weekend, as tired as I was, and I watched how God moved on that classroom, let me tell you something. We got a chance to touch the entire state of North Carolina. Over 100 ministers or so are going to go out and pastor a church somewhere or plant a church or evangelize a community. And they walked out in a day and a half, new. Ready to go. Equipped. At the end of the session, the dean of the school got up and told these people, he said, y'all just got your apostolic commission. He said, you being sent forth. He said, your ordination is going to come sometime in June, but understand something. God commissioned you today. You don't need your ministry license at this point. That's going to come. But what came on you today, only God can give that through apostles and prophets. God released a grace on that house. And I'm telling you, we're going to see a witness. I declare revival over 100-mile radius around this area in the name of Jesus. I want to see Dunn, Benson, Wilmington, Raleigh, Cary, Clayton, Lumberton, Fairmont, Pembroke, all the way down to south of the border where God give us the grace to reach the hand through evangelism. We want to start praying revival in every single community, every single house. People coming in to the presence of God and being restored back to where God wants them. Families in the name of Jesus, broken families shall come back together by the power of the Holy Ghost. Fathers shall indebtedly raise and develop their children without abusing them. In the name of Jesus, mothers will have weights lifted off of them and receive the support that they need to be able to provide and care. And couples will come together and represent family as God sees it again. Hallelujah. I'm telling you, God is going to bring it to pass in Jesus' name. And we have to line ourselves up with that. Amen? All right. I'm going to regress now. You may have your seats in the presence of the Lord. Children's ministry, you all can be released at this time. Youth ministries, whatever's going on there in the back. Nursery, go ahead and be released at this time. We're going to 0 through 12. Thank you. Zero through 12. I caught that look, Pastor Sheila. I got you. 0 through 12. As they're moving, I want you to open your Bibles. We'll raise our offering in just a moment. As we're moving, I want you to open up your Bibles. The first passage that we'll read will be back in Ezekiel chapter 36. Okay? We'll go there first. Ezekiel the 36th chapter. And then I want us to look also at, thank you, Lord. I really feel the presence of God. I really feel the presence of God, and I'm so grateful. Thank you, Jesus. Yeah, so we'll focus today on Ezekiel 36, 22 through 30. That'll be our passages that we're going to read. And then we're going to jump over to St. John chapter 5, verse 1 through 9. Those will be the two primary scriptures that we'll look at today, okay? So I want y'all to give it some time and some attention. I'm going to do everything in my power not to hold you guys and ladies longer than what you should be held for, okay? I want you to get a chance to really let the word of God penetrate and touch your heart. Amen? I'll say this before I dive head first back in, is that they did start moving dirt on the property. I hope y'all saw the pictures and the backhoes out there on the property. So we got some progress going. I'm going to be looking for the building to arrive here within the next day or so. That should be landing out on the property. And I got faith in God that this building project is going to move forward. Amen. So I'm going to ask you all to be in prayer with us that at least by the end of this year, we'll be moving from this temporary place to the place that God called us to. Amen. Let's be praying. But we don't want no shortcuts. We don't want no shortcuts on the contracting. Amen. So whatever time it needs to take, let it take that time because we want it right. Amen. Amen. All right. Let's get into the word of God. Let's go to the book of Ezekiel, chapter 36. Ezekiel 36. Good to see you, Apostle Walker. Amen. Prophetess Ebony, good to see you all. Blessings to you, each one of you all. All right. We keep going back to this scripture because when I study it, I keep looking at it from a perspective of how the Lord works on us. It's beautiful to see the hand of God working with an individual and with groups of people. And some of y'all don't realize it, but part of what I'm seeing in this scripture, much of what I'm seeing in this scripture, some of you all that have been here for the past couple of years, I'm watching God do that in you. Day by day by day, I'm seeing this progress. And I'm watching it, and it blesses me. Some of it, the Lord said, don't touch it. Just let me keep doing it. Because man can put his hand on something and blow it. Amen? In good faith. Anybody ever messed up something in good faith just getting in front of God? And what I'm learning, y'all, is when God got his hand on something, let God keep his hand on it. Amen? He don't need a substitute. And so he says here, in the book of Ezekiel chapter 36, I'm going to start with 22, okay? It says, therefore say unto the house of Israel, thus says the Lord God, I do not this for your sakes, O house of Israel, but for my holy name's sake, which you have profaned amongst the heathen wherever you went or whither ye went. And I will sanctify my great name, which was profaned amongst the heathen, which you have profaned in the midst of them. And the heathen shall know that I am the Lord God when I shall be sanctified in you before their eyes. And I love the fact that when you read that the Lord is sharing with a people who had steered away from his divine purpose and steered away from his word and steered away from his promise, that he's now made a decision, because I'm going to tell y'all something. God can use anybody he want to use. Somebody say, ask Balaam. Anybody know who Balaam is? Balaam was a prophet, even though he was speaking false narratives and billing people for prophecies. I got a problem with that. Amen? Balaam was a testing type, or he was a prophet, but he was charging people for prophecies. Go read your Bible history. And God had a problem with Balaam. And let me tell you what God will do. God used a jackass, a real one, to speak because Balaam was out of pocket. And I done made my mind up. Sometimes we talk about the rocks crying out. I don't want no jackass speaking for me. I don't need that. I'd rather obey than allow a jackass to make a fool out of me. And so God can use, the point has some humor on it, and it should. At the end of the day, why would God have to find a substitute for us? When he's given us everything that we need, according to the book of 1 Peter chapter 3, 2 Peter chapter 3, when it talks about the divine nature of God, the word says that God has given us everything that we need according to, in him, according to life and godliness. He says that we might be partakers of his divine nature, that we might be able to escape the world through lust. You see, and so God wants and has decided to use a group of people, not just one person, but an entire nation of people that have backslidden, or I'm going to say it like this because backslide is a nice word. What they've done is they have willingly disobeyed God. They had the truth, they had the evidence, they had the manifestation, they had the witness, and they allowed their fleshly desires to remove them from the presence and purpose of God. And in their disobedience, this is really a message to the church, in their disobedience, instead of God wiping that nation out like he did others, he stepped in and said, hold on a second. Y'all carrying my name. See, I'm not so upset about the nations that carried Baal and Ashtaroth and Molech and Dagon. I'm not worried about them nations. But y'all walking around here telling people, you God's people. Come on, America. Come on, the greatest nation on the planet. We walking around here telling people that we are the greatest nation on the planet, and rightfully so, but are we a nation that's in rebellion? Are we a people who know God's word and know God's will, but we are willingly segregating and separating ourselves from the word of God? Yeah. Y'all okay? One of the things I had to teach on this past weekend in my assignment to that body of believers was Christ culture versus secular culture. We taught apologetics on how to be defenders of the faith. Amen? And so when I'm talking to this house this morning, I want you all to grab a hold of the fact that God have not taken his hand off the house. He's not taking his hand off his people. And in fact, in this case, what it's showing is how he's going to step in because he has a covenant with Abraham and a promise with the father of this nation that there's a work that has to manifest through them. You see, that's why we can understand something, that God don't deal with superficial stuff. We want him to, right? We want God to deal with our feelings. We want God to deal with all this stuff that we go through. And a lot of the stuff that we deal with is really superficial, intellectual things. And the solution for intellectual issues is Romans chapter 12, verse 1. I beseech you, by the mercy of God, that you present your body a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is what? Reasonable service. One translation said it's the least we could do. But then the work of redemption, which we're going to deal with here in this passage, the work of redemption, which I'm questioning some of these people, and this is not a negative, right? When I teach this like this, I don't want y'all to drop your head in shame. When I teach this, I want us to recognize the difference between faith and religious dogma versus the gospel of Jesus Christ, which when the gospel message is delivered, right, the power and the presence of God is going to follow with signs and wonders. So every time the message of the kingdom is preached, if it's preached and there's just one person in the group that has faith, the power of God will move on that house just because one person had faith the size of a mustard seed. But when you have a backsliding nation, now God is coming and he said, I'm setting record with this because even out of this nation is going to come the manifestation of the forthcoming Christ. So there's a much bigger picture when he's talking about this nation here of Israel and the level of perversion that these people have involved themselves in. Okay? And so God is saying, what I'm going to do, watch this. He said, I'm going to sanctify my name. But he says, I'm going to sanctify my name through them. Somebody shout, that means there's going to have to be a lot of turning around. These people had worshiped God, Jehovah, right? And had offered up sacrifices. He taught them the format and the protocol for worship. And these people were committing perversion with foreign nations and had set up tents or groves, as the Word of God teaches. And all that pagan worship, though, instead of it being songs, they offered up sacrifices, human sacrifices that were sometimes children. They caused their children. When you hear the Bible say that, do not allow your children to be passed through fire, they set up altars made of iron and brass and offered their firstborn children up to demonic entities for special favors. You want to know why sexual perversion is so prevalent in the land? Because it's associated with false religion. You don't get false religion without sexual perversion. Because a part of their worship to demonic deities was these folks would bring in, and there were ungodly orgies created in these groves as acts of worship. I want y'all to understand this from a biblical perspective, how serious it is, because I think that at some point we start taking stuff for granted and we look at it as, oh, that's just church. No, no, no. It's a whole lot different than what people think. And I think that here in America, we have lost our reverence for God in a manner than what he expects it from us. Amen? A commercialized, crystallized, proselytized gospel does not save, because it's not the gospel. And Jesus said that if any man, Jesus said through Paul that if any man teach any other gospel than this one, which means that the word this denotes that there's only one. You can have all the religion you want, right? I hear him say it all the time. There's many roads that lead to Christ. Okay, it may lead you to Christ, but let me tell you something. Jesus said, I am the way, I'm the truth, and I'm the life. If any man come up any other way, he said he cometh as a thief and a robber. Amen. He's telling us that it all may lead you to a point to where you're going to find Jesus at some point. Because I can tell you this, you do dope long enough and you cry for help and you sincerely cry for help and you're on drugs, at some point God going to hear that cry. Now it's up to the individual to decide whether or not they're going to answer and be drawn in and allow God to do the work in them. And then it may take some time to go through a process to completely win it out your spirit. But there's nothing that humanity goes through that if the right cry of repentance out to God, that he won't by his spirit and in love draw us in and bring us to a place of healing. That's the kind of God we serve. And what we got to look for is consistency in him throughout history and consistency in him throughout scripture. See, it's one thing to sit here and take a microphone and put a whip in one hand and beat people to death because of the behavior. But it's another thing to deal with the seed. See, the church been dealing with the weed. And what God is saying, we need to deal with the seed. We've been dealing with everything that grows up around the issue, but what the issue really is. And even in our spiritual warfare teaching, we're telling people to get it to the root. Well, there's a manifestation before root, that seed form. And seed form, when it brings forth a demonic harvest, thorns, thistles, poverty, sickness, disease, family separating, abuse mentally and physically, laws being passed in government that are counterproductive to the kingdom of God, things that push women into vicarious situations and men into identity crisis. There is not just a root system problem, there's a seed problem. And so what he's saying here, he says, I want us to get back to the original intent of God and worship him like this, as he says, what? In spirit and truth. He says that the Father seeketh such to worship. I think it's in John 7, isn't it? The Father seeketh, the Father seeketh such to worship. They that worship must worship in spirit and truth. Don't it get exciting when they know that God is after us? But did you know that there was a protocol to get his attention? Did you know that before he got up and just took off and started seeking out, then there was two components that he had to identify? And the first one was a right spirit, and the next one was a truthful heart. So spirit and truth attract God. Spirit and truth. Spirit, a right spirit, little s. We worship him in a right spirit. What is a right spirit? Number one, it starts with repentance, right? Repentance opens the door, right, for reconciliation. Somebody write that down. Repentance opens the door for reconciliation. We want to be reconciled and restored by God. The first step is repent, right? Once we repent, which means we turn against it. We turn against it. If somebody says it's a choice. It's a decision. Say it again. It's a choice. It's a decision. Not, God, help me repent. Lord, help me repent. Lord, just help me repent. No, no, no. That's your choice. You can't ask me to manipulate and manage everything about you, and then when I get you okay, then you step back and you want it all back. I'm not a man that I should lie, nor the son of man that I repent. We just read that the power of God was available to heal everyone. And God said, what I'm going to do is I'm going to start dealing with some folk, and I'm going to sanctify my name amongst the heathen, because I'm going to use people who backslid. Help me, Jesus. And I'm going to turn their life around. I'm going to help them get it together. I'm going to help them get back on their feet. I'm going to help them to come forth with a mighty praise. Watch this. And nowhere in this scripture you're going to find that because they messed up a year ago, that now that they're back on street call straight, that they got to drop their head. God said, I know they messed up, but I still love them. I know they got themselves in a bad situation, but I still love them. And I got my name on them. I'm not a man that I should lie or the son of man that I should repent. Some of you parents in here really need to be giving God praise right now, because you got some children out there that was taught the word of God, that have rebelled against the word of God, that have walked away from God and walked away from his church. And you need to start calling a return on your seed, a return on your investment, because the Bible teaches us this. He says that when you raise a child in the way that they should go, when they grow old, they shall not depart from it. Now that was Solomon saying that, right? Solomon was making it. Now Solomon also wrote the Song of Solomon, and he also wrote the book of Ecclesiastes. Those three books are books that were written under heaven. If you look at Ecclesiastes, the third chapter, he says there's a time and a season for all things under heaven. And by the time he starts writing these books, right, he's at a place to where his heart has become hardened, because Solomon, who was the wisest person or king that Israel had in that season, this man, listen to me, Solomon's anointing was so powerful. And the wisdom of God that rested upon this man because of the initial prayer that he asked God when he got inducted into the kingdom of God, as far as a king, was very simple. He said, God, I don't ask you for riches. God, I'm not asking you for land. I'm not asking you for territory or new houses. I ask you for one thing. He said, if you're going to call me to lead these people, give me a wise and an understanding heart. And I believe that every single person on this planet that professes the name of Christ, the first thing we should ask God after we repent is, Lord, give me a wise and understanding heart. Because if you can have a wise and understanding heart, let me tell you something, you can bring solution to any issue and any problem that comes into your life without compromising your beliefs. Somebody shout, I'm not going to compromise. Come on, you got to get it in your spirit that you're not going to compromise anything. I don't care how much pressure comes on you from the people around you. There's going to come times, dear friends and family, you're going to get lonely. You're going to feel like you're by yourself. You're going to feel like you don't have the support. You're going to feel like you're isolated. You're out here on a solo all by yourself. You're going to feel agitated, aggravated. You're not going to want to be bothered with people. You're going to stop answering phones. All that's going to happen. But at the end of the day, the same God that got you to this place is the same God that's going to bring you through this place. And you should give God praise for that, because some of the things that we think is the devil is really God purging the unclean thing out of us. And if it don't hurt, if it's hurting, somebody shout, it's because I'm breaking covenant with Satan. That's why it's hurting me. My flesh is acting up because I'm breaking covenant with the devil. He said, your ways are not my ways and my thoughts are not your thoughts. He said, but let me tell you something. Don't worry about that. He said, I put a seed in you. He said, and I'm going to tell you something about my seed. He said, my seed, my word shall not return void. He said, it will prosper and perform in that which it was sent to do. Let me let you look at agriculture. Let me let you look at science. He said, as surely as the rain cometh down. Do you hear me? God says, I'm going to let you go through a season of your life, and then I'm going to call a return on this seed. How many of you in here this morning are ready to give God what he's asking for? Give him praise right now. Give him praise right now. Somebody say, prove it. Prove it. Watch this. Verse 24, because I'm going to take you from amongst the heathen. I'm going to take you from amongst the heathen. You can parallel that to St. John, I believe it is, the 15th and 16th chapter, where he says, I am the true vine and my father's a husbandman. Every branch in me that bears not fruit, he takes it away. Anybody dealing with some things? You feel like some things are being taken from you? Some people being taken from you? You see, it's a, thank you. It's a, thank you, son. It's not, listen, this is not a negative here. This is not a negative. This is God setting you up for success. This is God setting you up for success. Somebody say, God is setting me up for success. We're going to demonstrate this in just a few moments through the book of Luke, okay? But let's work this piece. Because if you don't understand this process, you can let the enemy frustrate your purpose in building, all because you don't understand what's next. And see, God ain't hiding nothing from you. God ain't hiding. Somebody say, God's not hiding nothing from me. The word says, I will withhold no good thing from you. It is the Lord's pleasure to give you the kingdom. What father whose child asked him for an egg would give him a serpent? So then how do you men, he's talking to wicked people, having evil in your hearts, even think to be able to do good for them that ask? He said, you are of your father the devil. That man was a manslayer when he began. He's a lie and the truth is not in him. Somebody shout, you better not believe a thing that the devil tells you. And one of the things you can take from that is that just as God got kids, so does Satan. We ain't ready for that. Oh, my God, love everybody, people. Satan has children, just like God does. Y'all okay? Let me ask y'all something, church. Do you know the difference? Or have some of y'all been loving devils? You know devils don't repent, right? Oh, my God, I ain't in the right house this morning. Y'all want me to go back and start over again and start doing the praise and worship thing and hollering and crying? That's what y'all want. How many of y'all been loving on devils, hoping that devils repent? Do you understand devils cannot change? It's not that they don't want to. The torment for devils is they may want to, but they can't, because there's no room for repentance. So they're always looking for an open door or open gate. When an unclean spirit cometh out of a person, the Bible says that it walketh through dry places. That let me know he ain't seeping through walls. He ain't poking out behind. He ain't coming through TV screens. He ain't coming up out the lampshade. This thing walk in an earth suit. They're dressed up like people, but they're demons. Y'all all right? And here's what they look for. They look for an open window. Watch this. We're going to call it this, an opportunity. What opportunity are they looking for? For you to doubt. What's the opportunity they look for? For you to lose faith. What's the other opportunity to look for you to get discouraged? What's the other opportunity for you to be afraid to be by yourself? What's the other opportunity to look for you to have a big thing coming up and you have a history of flopping and failing, but God says, I'm getting ready to do a new thing in you. Oh God, I'm getting ready to do something in you that you did not believe that you could get accomplished, but now you will accomplish it because you're depending on me to get you through it. He said, I'm going to sanctify my great name. Amen. We got 30 minutes. I'm going to pick it up. He said, and here's how I'm going to start. The first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take you from amongst the heathen. Somebody say, thank God for that. How many of y'all sick and tired of being sick and tired of everywhere you go, every environment, every community? You can't even halfway go to church sometimes. It's like you always in a room full of heathens. Y'all all right? But the Bible is telling us, God said, I'm going to give you relief. I'm going to pull you away from heathen for a little while. Watch this. Because what God does is he delivers you. He heals you. He sets you free. He fills you with the Holy Ghost. He sanctifies you. He baptizes you in fire. He gives you a prayer language and increases your faith until you believe that it's not always going to be like this. There is a preeminent coming where he's going to come back to get his church without spot or wrinkle. I'm preaching the gospel in here. Do you hear what I'm saying? This thing, how we see it, ain't always going to be like this. But the part that you're going to play in it is after God raises you up, after he heals you, after he delivers you, after he sanctifies you, after he sprinkles you and washes you and makes you clean again. He's preparing you for surgery. Somebody shout, God is preparing us for surgery. Can't you see it? He's putting the scrubs on. He's preparing himself. He's sprinkling you with clean water, which lets us know that the water that some of y'all been dipped in, what's that represent, Janae? It represents the efforts for relieving yourself of the things that's been burdening you down. Dirty water of addiction, dirty water of ungodly fantasy, dirty water of trying to find a reroute way around Jesus Christ to get to the promise, the dirty water of false doctrine and religion, dirty water. Somebody shout dirty water. And that's why I'm so glad that Jesus picked the nastiest river in Israel to be baptized in, because as John was baptizing people in the dirty Jordan, the baptism of repentance, the Bible says that John starts talking about Jesus, and he said, there's one that's coming. He's mightier than I am. I'm not even worthy to tie his shoestrings. He said, I'm going to baptize you with water. He said, but the one that's coming, he's going to baptize you with the Holy Ghost, and he's going to baptize you with fire. And I'm wondering right here in Divine Empowerment International, if we are a people that believe in principle, but we get away from his presence. Because the minute that you start believing in principle, you're going to have success in business. You're going to have success in crossing T's and dotting I's, and you'll see the manifestation of reciprocity operating in your life. But the soul that needs to be delivered from those things that bring us into a place of condemnation. What is it when the Bible says, what does it profit a man to gain the world and then lose his soul? Money ain't your problem. Your mind is your problem. Amen, somebody. I said, money is not your problem, nor the lack thereof. It's the way we think about money. The Bible tells us we cannot serve two masters. We can't serve God and mammon. And if the only time that we feel good about ourselves is when we're riding good and sitting high, somebody shout, there's something wrong with your religion. There's something wrong with your relationship. You don't have to lie to boost yourself up in the eyes of people. No. Just be who you are where you are, because these folk you trying to impress don't have a heaven or a hell to put you in, and ain't none of them paying your bills. So at the end of the day, you better keep it right and keep it real and let God go to work. Because God said, when I get to working on this thing, he says, I'm going to prepare you for surgery. I'm going to get you away from the thing that made you dirty in the first place. Then I'm going to isolate you. And then I'm going to start washing on you. I'm going to do it with clean water, unlike the people in your past did. They said, all you got to do is join the church, and everything about your life is going to get better. Just hook up with that prophet and hook up with that apostle, and everything is going to be fine. And you're going to find out that true men and women of God not only carry an anointing, but they also carry a warfare. And if your mind is not right and your soul is not right, the warfare that attacks your man and woman of God is going to creep right into your life. And you better be ready when you come up under that covering to be able to accommodate the level of pressure that's going to come along with the assignment. I'm talking to my armor bearers, my intercessors, my worship leaders, my prayer warriors. Understand that when you step into the kingdom of God, this is not a showcase or a performance. Somebody shout, this is life. This is the life that we've been called to live. And God said, the second thing I'm going to do, he says, that I'm going to take you, and somebody shout, this is going to be the best bath you ever had. I'm talking about the best bath you ever had. It's better than the bath that Esther took before she had to go before the king. It's better. Somebody shout, it's better. It's the best bath that you will ever have. He said, because I'm going to bathe you and I'm going to cleanse you from filth. I'm going to cleanse you. Somebody shout, not just what I've done, but God said, I'm going to cleanse you from what's been done to you. Oh God, come on church. Some of you in the building, you've not done anything dirty yourself. Somebody shout, but people have done you dirty. And God said, when I start cleansing you, I'm going to cleanse you not only from what you caused, but I'm going to cleanse you from what they caused. In other words, I'm going to strip you of the nightmares. I'm going to strip you of the burden. I'm going to strip you of the dysfunctional relationships. I'm going to strip you of the bad parenting. I'm going to strip you from the fear of isolation. I'm going to strip you from the fear of being by yourself. And I'm going, after I get finished with you, washing you and washing you from your filth. He said, then I'm going to get your idols away from you. I'm going to get those things that you put before me out of your presence. Come on, Dagon. When the man of God went into the temple, the Bible says that the statue of Dagon continued to raise itself up. But the prophet stepped in, brothers and sisters. And when the prophet prayed, somebody shout, prophets need to pray. When the prophet prayed, the Bible says that the statue of Dagon fell down flat on his face. But the priest of Dagon kept going back into the temple of Dagon because they could not live without perversion. Do y'all hear me, church? That's one of the things that we've got to watch for, is staying away from things that drive us into a place of perversion. The Bible said that the priest raised it back up. Come on, church. I need to talk to you, brothers and sisters. That's why even in the church, somebody say, even in the church, we got to be careful about what vestments we wear, because some of the vestments we wear did not come from the priesthood. Some of the vestments that we wear, hallelujah, all in the name of being in ecclesiastical order, are not vestments that depict worship. They're vestments that depict Dagon worship with your fish head. Are you hearing me, brothers and sisters? They don't like my teaching right now, but I believe by faith that God is calling the entire church into divine order. Amen, somebody. And so when we step away from that, God said, I'm not just going to remove you from the heathen and wash you and make you whole. He said, but I'm going to change the way you worship. Somebody shout, I've been worshiping God, burdened down, broken down, beat down. But what's going to happen when you begin to praise him with a sanctified mind and praise him with a sanctified spirit? Am I talking to the right house? I need 15 people in here to lift your voices up and say, God, if you can wash Peter with his nasty mouth, if you can wash Saul with his crazy self, if you can let a woman with an alabaster
box come into your presence that got a history of harlotry and take spikenard and wash your feet and dry with a hair. Surely you can take me with my messed up self and all the mistakes that I have made and receive my worship. Somebody lift your hands up and say, I feel like worship is going to change my life in this very hour. Somebody shout yes. Give him praise in here. Y'all flow with me now. Y'all got to watch me on both sides. Watch this. Somebody said, I got to worship him. And I'm going to worship him with confidence. And this is the confidence that we have in him. That he that has begun a work in me, he's able to perform it until the coming of the Lord Jesus. Somebody give God praise for about 15 seconds and say, Father, I'm giving you permission to work on me. You've already washed me. You've already removed me. You've already separated and sanctified me. Now it's time for my new heart. I'm ready for a new heart. I'm ready for a new spirit. I'm ready for a new assignment. God be the glory. Who in this building is ready to take your life to the next level? Then shout right quick. Come on, Holy Ghost. Do the work that you need to do in me. Create in me a clean heart and renew a right spirit. And whatever you do, don't take your grace. Don't take your anointing. Don't take your spirit, and I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall be in my mouth. Shall yes. Praise him in here for 15 seconds. You better shout. You better open up your mouth and say, I'm ready for surgery. I'm ready for open heart surgery. My mouth is open wide. My hands are lifted up. I need the rain, the former and the latter, in the first month. Yes, Lord. Go on and bless him and receive it. He said, what's I did with your mind? Then I'm going to give you a spirit. I told the class last Friday night. I said, we've been teaching it wrong. We so ready for people to get the Holy Ghost, and we want them to speak in tongues so bad that we don't care about the condition of their heart. With our religious self, so ready to write somebody's name down on the forum, talk about who got baptized on Sunday. And we're reporting false narratives. This takes time. It takes time. Not because it's God's fault, because people struggle changing their mind. God can do hebasi, tatayamashi. God can do and bring change in the moment and the twinkling of an eye. That's how fast God can move. God can heal anytime he shows up in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, because that's the type of God we serve. It's not God's issue that things are not working out. Somebody shout, it's your mindset. It's your unstable, unpredictable, indecisive mind. But God is not struggling with what he wants to do with you. He said, I know the thoughts that I have towards you, my child, for they be thoughts of peace and not of evil, to show unto you the expected end. God said, I got an expectation for you, and I need you to meet my expectation. We were here crying over people that don't love us no more. And never did love us. We walk around. here moping like your whole world is in there, and God done gave you a new heart for real. Ain't nothing worse than a troubled mind. That's why the word said that perfect love he said perfect love cast out all fear, because fear have torment. And if you're being tormented, you're not letting the love of God deal with that issue. Because God love don't play. He's a jealous God. You ain't gonna serve mammon and idols and serve him and expect him to perform on the level that he's gonna perform on. Y'all all right? I ain't mad at nobody but the devil. I ain't mad at y'all. But I done made my mind up. Do you hear me? I done made my mind up. I got something I'm willing to die for finally in my life. I got something I believe in so much. I'm willing to lose everything for it. But I will not stop. I will not stop. I will not stop. And you got to get that same determination in your spirit that regardless of what comes to you, Pastor Sheila, that you are not going to stop, because nothing can separate you from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. This thing got to mean something to you, man. Verse 27, he said, I'm going to put my statutes in you after you come out of surgery. He said, I'm not going to dump all of it on you at one time, because it's going to be too much. You're going to be coming off the anesthesia. When you come out of surgery, it's going to take you a minute to wake up. But when you come off this surgery that I'm getting ready to take you through, this soul surgery that I'm getting ready to take you through, when I start getting down there and dealing with the latent powers of the soul that we've allowed success to cover up, he said, it's going to surface when you fast. It's going to surface when you consecrate. It's going to surface when you separate yourself. It's surfacing for a reason, for you to deal with it. And after I get you to where you're ready and you're coming back to your senses, you're going to realize I've been changed. I've been changed. I've been healed. I've been delivered. I've been set free. Has anybody got that testimony? Does anybody want that testimony? If that's you, just right there, lift your hands. I believe God get ready to set down on this house. I believe he's getting ready to set down on the house. I believe he's getting ready, because the power of God, the presence of God is able to heal. And if you begin to cry out to him right where you're at, I know that God is not going to leave you. He's not going to forsake you. You just got to open up your mouth and ask him nicely. You just got to ask him nicely. You just got to ask him with some reverence and with some respect. Father, it's me today standing in the need of prayer. I'm standing here asking you as humbly as I know how. Oh God, do what you have to do. Do it how you want to do it. Do it when you want to do it. I'm going to be satisfied with your presence. I'm going to be satisfied with your will. Write your word on my heart so I can hide it in your precepts. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. For in your presence there is a fullness of joy. And at your right hand there are pleasures forevermore. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I praise you. And I bless you right now for those that received it, for those that are letting you touch them right now. Lord, even touch that hard heart. Touch that hard heart that have been broken over and over and over and again. Touch that heart, Lord. Give that heart space to trust again, to believe again, to confide again. In the name of Jesus,
Hide us in your holy pavilion. Be our strong tower. Be our burden bearer. Be our battle axe. In the name of Jesus. Jesus walked up on a man in Luke. He's sitting at the pool of Bethesda. He's been sitting there for 38 years. 38 years, this man has been sitting in the same place every week. And the Bible says that he has an infirmity on him. Now, the scriptures don't always say what the infirmity is. I don't know all of it. But the Bible does say that the man is impotent, which means that he's been in poverty for at least 38 years, that he's been unproductive for at least 38 years, that he's been down and out for at least 38 years, that he's had no success in his life for each 38 years. It means for at least 38 years, everything he touched failed. And so many times we celebrate the moment that the trouble stopped, but we don't always deal with the trauma after the trouble stopped from the 38 years prior to it stopping. Because what happens, if you find that dude right there, you're going to find Jesus healed him. And after Jesus healed him, the first thing Jesus saw, he said, this man been here for a while. You know how I know he knew he had been there for a while? It ain't because Jesus knew him. Because he had started making, begging his home. There were five porches at the Pool of Bethesda. What the Pool of Bethesda represents is the significance of having a holy place in every community. Because the people gathered at the Pool of Bethesda year round, and there was a belief that those waters had the power to heal. The wise story said that there was an angel that would come down and trouble the water. Can I tell y'all something? We don't need that angel. We just need the hand of God. We just need the baptism of the Holy Ghost and fire. That's what we need. We don't need that pool. But the significance, Sister Buckley, of the Pool of Bethesda is the reason why the saints still need to gather. It's bringing in a holy sanctuary, a place of worship. Don't let nobody convince you that you can just get it at home. There's something that happens when the saints come to church. It is science even shows that people that have glossolalia, that have spoken in tongues, when they're speaking in tongues, science shows that stress is coming off the mind. It shows that depression is lifting. It shows that they back that 5% margin up of not being able to think straight. Don't you let nobody tell you that the power of God cannot heal your mind. That's why Jude 20 says, building yourself up on your most holy faith by praying in the Holy Ghost. We need some brothers and sisters that know how to pray in the power of the Holy Spirit. That's what's going to break these yokes and lift these burdens. Your principles are not going to work without power. So that pool, Janae, represented a community that understood that there needs to be a corporate place of worship in that community. Some of us have even taken the prayer altars out of our homes. There should be a prayer, a place where God meets you at home. A place you can dedicate to Him. And it's a tabernacle. Can I share something with y'all? Let me tell you how I know it was a tabernacle. The first person I met that prayed like that was her grandmama. First person I met that carried her tabernacle with her everywhere she went was my wife's grandmama. I was in the world and I loved to get high when I was in the street. I'm telling you, I would drink and stay high. Y'all laughing, but I'm telling y'all the truth. And I hope that every time you see me, you know that God can heal. And that God can deliver. I'm not glorifying that lifestyle. I want you to see the evidence of the things that I've gone through that God have taken me out of and continues to take me out of. But That woman was praying on the side of the bed that I was sleeping in. She come down to visit from Pennsylvania. I called myself getting ready to go out, so I went and smoked me a blunt. I come flying back in the house because I forgot something. I don't even know what I forgot. And Tori, when I went in that room, her grandma was on the side of the bed praying on the side that I sleep on. I walked in the room and I heard, "Oh God, oh God, oh God." I said, "What is that?" And I tipped around the corner and she was sitting on her knees with her hands like this on the side of the bed. "Oh God, oh God." And then she goes, "Shandadadadaba, shandadadadaba, oh God." The power of God. I feel the Holy Ghost. That's how I pray now. And I got that prayer language from her when I saw her pray like that. And I began to pray for the first time in church because them Pentecostals was trying to teach me how to speak in tongues. And God gave me my own prayer language. I didn't need you telling me to ta-ta-ta, sending them on a Honda and riding on no Toyota. God gave me my own prayer language. Amen, somebody. And when I pray, shike basaya, koshi anarara basiente. When I begin to pray in the Holy Ghost, heaven began to hemorrhage. But I got it from somebody that took their tent of meeting with them. I walked in the room, Janae, and that good stuff I smoked left my mind. I was not high no more. And I was like, I said, "Let me get up out of here because I don't know what she's doing, but whatever it is, it's real." So we have a place. She got her place where she prays. And I know it's in the bedroom. And I got a place where I pray. And it's in my prayer room. It's in my study. Where are you praying? Where are you praying at? Where's your altar? Or are you just waiting when you think you can show up for somebody to pray for you? There have to be Jacob's ladder in your house. There got to be a place where the angels are seeing and de-seeing, coming up and coming down, that can give you information. There have to be a place where you can put on there an altar and say, "This place shall be called from this day forth Yahweh Yireh, because the Lord has provided, the Lord will provide, and he will always provide." There's got to be a tent of meeting. Do you hear me, brothers and sisters? We're trying to get to the tabernacle, but I'm talking about your tent of meeting. I'm talking about the place where you meet God at before you come to church. And if you can get that tent of meeting straight and get it sanctified and consecrated, I'm telling you that the power of God will rest on your house if you just set yourself up to let God meet you again. He said, "I miss my church. I miss my bride. I miss my people, but I'm going to do something for you that your eyes have not seen and your ears have not heard. I'm going to sanctify you and sanctify my name through you by pulling you out of that idolatry and out of that perversion. And I'm going to present you before myself as a bride without spot and a bride without wrinkle." Somebody in this house shout amen and give God praise in here. "For the gospel of the kingdom shall be preached and all the inhabited earth for a witness to all nations, and then the end will come. And this is the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, that he was crucified, that he was buried, that he rose on the third day. And as he rose, he raised us up with him. For he said in his word, 'If I be lifted up, I draw all men unto me.'" Somebody in your family gonna be saved and born again because of the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Somebody give him praise in here for a bright future. Somebody give him praise in here for a fresh promotion. Somebody give him praise in here for a fresh wind of the Holy Ghost. Somebody shout, "Power is coming to my house." I said, "Power is coming to my house." Give him praise in the house of the Lord, saints.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true.
Hey, Baba, sir.
And with thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary, Lord, for you. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, and with thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary, Lord, for you. Lord, for you, Lord. Lord, for you, Lord. Sanctuary, Lord, for you.
If you're in this building today, I want y'all to stand with me. Would y'all stand with me? And did you think today is your day? Yeah. Be born again? Or to renew your vows with Jesus? Won't you lift them hands right where you at?
Lord, prepare me a sanctuary. Sanctuary. Lord, for you.
Lord, you saw those hands that went up. You see the ones that went up. But Lord, even more than that, you see those hearts. Sprinkle them with clean water. Cleanse them from the idolatry. Rabasandarabasoto. Cleanse him from the perversion. Cleanse us. Wash us. Make us whole again. In the name of Jesus. And receive us back into your kingdom. In Jesus' name. And we'll be careful to give your name the praise and the glory and the honor. In Jesus' name. Amen. If you want to celebrate your renewal or your salvation, put those hands together. If you want to just celebrate that, if you really want to celebrate it like you just got something new. I'm going to ask Prophet Ashley if she'll come on up. We're going to give y'all space. I want y'all to go home and let that word resonate in your spirit. I'm not going to push no more. I'm going to stop right there. I want you to chew it, right? And then I want you to digest it until it becomes a part of you. And then believe him for what he wants for you. My whole heart's fluttering in a good way right now. I feel something. All right, let's prepare our giving. Let's prepare our giving. It's a good place to give when the Spirit is sitting on us too. Let's prepare our giving. Let's prepare our offerings and our sacrifice. Prepare our tithes. Woo! Amen. Let's give like we are paying this building off. Can we do that? Let's give like we're paying this bad boy off. Give like we're paying it off. Amen. Amen. Give like we're paying it off. I thank y'all for your liberal and consistent giving. I want to shout out to those of you that have kept your commitments. I want to just say thank you. Will y'all give God praise for those ones that have kept those shortfall commitments? Give God praise for them. Thank you. Thank you so much for keeping your word and keeping your commitment to God. Thank you. We're doing the exact same. And then some, I think. We're doing that and then some. Okay, well, that's fine. We're going to keep doing that. Amen. Because I done told you, y'all, I'm not going to let y'all do nothing that we ain't taking the lead in doing. Amen. Not going to ask you for tithes and we ain't tithing more or tithing just as much. Amen. I'm going to stop saying that I always want to be the biggest tither in the building. I'm going to pray somebody make more money than me. Amen. I'm going to pray that prayer. Amen. Give me somebody to catch up to. How about that? Lord, that's what I'm going to pray. Lord, give me somebody that I got to catch up to on giving. That's what I want to pray. Amen. I won't even be mad at you. But you ain't going to outlove me, though. I'm going to tell you that right now. Amen. Amen and amen. All right. There's several ways we can sow. Several ways we can sow. Media team, I'm going to ask you guys to do one thing for me. You don't have to do it today. But from this day forward, every time we give, I want y'all to show that first screen. And then let's put a picture of our new building up. Huh? It should still be on there? Okay, I want y'all to show that going forward every single Sunday, okay? Show the screen first. Let me, once I give the directives on the giving, right after that, switch right to that new facility. Amen? And we are in process of building our diplomat center. We're going to raise up some world-class leaders out of this place. Amen? I got word that I will be going through, final word, I will be going through my ambassador's training in September. So Lord has accepted my name as a world peace ambassador for you for the UN. And so I'll be going through that training in September and looking at, y'all pray for your old apostle. It's been a couple of years in the making, but it finally got word over the weekend that my name was actually submitted, then it was accepted. So by the end of the year, I'll be going through an official governmental inauguration with several world leaders across the nation, and this ain't no baby cake stuff here. This is the real deal. Amen, amen. This is the real deal. So it ain't to take no picture with the president. It's gonna be pray for that joker. Pray for that joker. Pray for the president. Pray for nations. Yeah. Amen. But I take it serious. I take it serious. And I count it an honor. Amen. So y'all pray for myself and Prophetess Sheila as we continue to try to lead this house and the network that God has assigned us to and the church at large. Okay? All right. When you have your giving, I'm going to ask you to rest to your feet, even if you've already given, just out of reverence. I'm going to pray over the giving. If you can stand, please, if you're giving. Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, I ask you to bless this offering, bless the giving today, as you always do. You always stretch us and multiply us and increase us. Thank you for every open door that man cannot shut. I thank you for the fruit that you've given us here within the ministry. Thank you for every liberal giver and tither in this ministry. Even our online family, we thank you for them who support from both near and far. We pray, God, for your mighty blessings to be upon them in their lives. And it is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen, amen, amen. I'm going to turn this over to Pastor Sheila, and she's going to lead you from there.
I mean, just two quick announcements before we go. First of all, I want to extend our heartfelt thanks for all of you who jumped in and served the Leach Boykin family. Thank you so much. We appreciate you guys, and they expressed their appreciation as well. Sister Boykin is in the back. She thanks you all as well. But I personally want to thank you all that you all showed up to and helped out. Okay, all right. Apostle said he'll open the doors of the church next Sunday. But thank you all for that. Don't forget, men, coming up this Saturday at 9 o'clock will be our Divine Sons Breakfast with the Brothers. Come on out at 9 o'clock. They'll be meeting in the fellowship hall. There's a flyer, but they're still on the which color. There you go. It's a time of edification, enrichment, and engagement. This coming Saturday, April 20th at 9 a.m., okay? Bring somebody with you, okay? Also, women also coming up on May the 4th will be our time of fellowship, our Divine Daughters roundtable coming up at 9:30 on that Saturday. Come on out. Mother Book will be back by then. She's excited to be back with you, with us for that roundtable. We had a great time last time that we had our women's roundtable, so we expect to see you guys out as well on that on May the 4th. Also, don't forget, coming up this Wednesday will be our children's and youth development. This Wednesday will be Biblical Principles. They're learning the Beatitudes. So come on out, bring your children out. Adults will be here in the sanctuary at 7:30 for our adult discipleship lesson. So we hope to see you all on Wednesday night, all right? All right, all hearts and minds are clear. Come on and stand to your feet. We're getting ready to give. Go ahead and stand and bring your offering. Lift your hands up. Now may the grace of God and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit may it rest, rule, and abide with us all, both now and forevermore. And let the redeemed of the Lord say, amen. Amen. Consider yourself dismissed.